So, let's do it the next step in FIR filter example. FIR filter example, just to get an idea how this whole works. And so the example is a moving average. So moving average is just the following in terms of FIR terms. So we've got just one delay step. And so we're multiplying this output here by half, and this here also by half. And these are very often called tabs, so like water tabs. So that's in the in this way here, halfway open. Okay, so after we've multiplied this with a factor half, we just add this up here and send this out. So that's our input signal x of n, and that's our output signal y of n. So if we just make a simple table with the time steps, the input and the output, then we can have a look, for example, how this whole system, so that's time step 0, 2, 3, 4, 5, acts on a delta pulse. So a delta pulse in this case is just the one at x, and then the rest is just 0. Yeah, so this is here a delta pulse. Delta pulse. So the one here is obviously directly showing up here. So we've got in the first time step the one here. And then this is here still 0. So this gives us just a half. So at the next time step, the x has become 0 again. So we just write 0 here. But then the 1 has progressed to this point here. So we're getting the half here. And so again, you get half now. So then the next time step here, then the 1 is obviously replaced again by 0. And the 0 here is a 0 again. So we are getting 0, 0, 0, and 0 again. So our impulse response is essentially half and half. So this way we can directly also write this down in our Z transform, because we know that Z2 minus 1 is a delay. So we can directly write half Z2 minus 1, because this is our delay here. So the z2 minus 1 shows up here as this t here. And these are our factors here. So that's essentially z2 0, and therefore it's 1. So it's just here the half. And this is a half delayed by one time step. That's our transfer function here. Okay, so now, what is the frequency response of that? So frequency response of our function h of z, which was or is half plus half z2 minus 1. So we know, in order to create the frequency response, we just do e to j omega. Yeah, so this gives us in here half plus half to e to minus j omega. So we just need to basically now turn this into a nice form in order to see our frequency response here. So there we just, as a trick, we're trying, or the aim is to turn this into a real multiplied by a imaginary product. because at the end we would like to calculate the absolute value of this. So in order to do this, so what we could just do is we do the trick here and write this the way that we are pulling out e2 minus half j omega out of this here, and then just leave the rest here as e2 half j omega, so this then gives 1 here again, plus e2 minus half j omega, yeah, so that we turn this into this just by pulling out this term here. And so the idea behind this is that we know this is here 2 times cosine omega, oh, half omega, omega half. Let's do this this way. So then our result here is, so we've got a complex phase factor e2 minus half j omega, and this is then multiplied by this cosine half omega. So now we've got a complex phasor here, and we've got just the real part here. So this makes it now easy to calculate the amplitude response and also the phase factor of that. So let's do this.
Okay, let's look at the amplitude response. So for that we just need to take the absolute value of our function. So something like that. So this means we can ignore our exponential here and just have a look at the cosine. So this here can we can omit, so e2j, and this one is just 1, and so therefore we don't need to bother about this. And so this omega here, this runs from minus pi to plus pi. Remember, we are in the sample system. Or we could also say, so that's in terms of omega, or in terms of normalized frequencies, this would be 0.5 to plus minus 0.5 to plus 0.5 in terms of normalized frequencies. And so how does this look like as a plot? It's obviously not very difficult to imagine. So if this is here pi and this is minus pi, then we get a function out like this here. So that's our omega here, and that's our h2e j omega here. And so we see already, so at Nyquist here, the response is 0, so that's here 0, and then here that's when it's DC, then the response is at maximum. Okay, so let's try this out now in Python, just to see if Python is actually able to calculate a cosine in the first place, and then let's just become a bit more tricky and use more advanced Python features. Okay, so I've imported NumPy, and so what we need to do is we need to create our omega vector. So that needs to run from minus pi to plus pi, and let's see, we take 100 samples for omega. And then we just need to have some matplot library as usual. So matplot library imported, and then we can just plot this now here. So plot numpy, and we take the cosine, and that's 0.5 multiplied by omega, and then I've seen I've already out of laziness omitted the absolute value here, because the cosine is just positive, hopefully. PLT dot plot. So we see here, so the what I've just scribbled here on the paper, that the maximum output of this filter is at zero and it suppresses everything at Nyquist. That was our expectation. That's just also quite simple to see this actually when we go back to the circuit diagram. And so let's say, so we look first at the Nyquist frequency. So remember that was here, if this was here our pi omega, and this here h2 e to j omega, Nyquist frequency is here, and our transfer or amplitude response says there's a zero output here at the Nyquist frequency. So why is this the case? So if we think of our averaging filter here, which has just a factor here of half and also half, and then we've got our summation unit here. And so if this is our input x of n and that's our output here y of n, so then what means Nyquist frequency? And remember, that's the highest frequency possible in a sampled system here. Highest frequency possible. So what means that again? So if we have here n, and that's our x of n, and this means one sample goes up, next sample goes down, the next one goes up again, and then the next one goes down again. So we have here plus one, minus one, plus one, minus one, and so on. And so we see already, if we feed this here into our filter here, that this will always cancel out because of the alternating input here. So for example, the if the plus one is here, then definitely minus one will be here, and then obviously half minus or minus half gives us zero. So this gives us always zero at the output. Yeah, so for example, half minus half is zero if we have a half coming in here. And then obviously the other way around also works. Minus half plus half is also zero. So in any case, we're getting zero, so that works. So how is this at DC? So if we're looking at DC, so what means DC? In signal processing terms, DC just obviously means this the input onto our filter is just constant. So when we think of our signal delay line here, so we have a factor of half and a factor of half. And so that's our summation here. And so if this x of n, and that's our of y of n, and obviously if you see, so a constant number, so any kind of constant number is also here constant, and then the output will be the same again. So therefore, that's also constant number again. And so coming back to our to our frequency response. So if this is here omega, and that's our h of e to j omega, so then the one here makes sense at DC, because we are, if we're sending something constant in, we're getting exactly the same out. So therefore the filter is doing nothing. It's just a factor of one which is applying to it. So for example, if we scaled everything here, these coefficient to by factor 2, then the output would be also 2 times higher. So that's very simple. And so let's make a more interesting case. Yeah, so let's do the frequency response by sending a test signal in there. So frequency response by sending in a test signal. A test signal into the filter, and we do this with Python commands. So our test signal, our test signal is just noise. So why noise? Because noise contains all frequencies, obviously in a statistical way. Yeah. So we take noise, and because it contains all frequencies. I'm not going into detail. If there's evenly distributed or energy distributed, there's also white and pink noise and other things. But let's just assume here that we just say there are all frequencies in there, and roughly this will be the case. So obviously we need to check that. And so for this purpose we do all the analysis in Python. So the advantage of doing this in this way is we can just treat our filter essentially as a black box, and we could just try out any kind of filter with that. And so what we do is, so the first step is we need to create some noise. Let's just create some space here. And so the amazing thing is that NumPy also has a noise generator. So NumPy random, and we're creating normal distributed noise around 0, standard deviation 1, and 1000 samples. So if I do that, then there are some random numbers in there. Let's just plot them. PLT plot of x. So we see that looks pretty much like noise. And so let's have a look at the spectrum, because I said that this essentially contains all frequencies here. So let's see if there are actually all frequencies in it. And so now we need to do this with the Fourier transform here. So I take from NumPy the FFT subdirectory, and then FFT, and I do a Fourier transform of our noise, and so let's plot that. So if I, and now I need to do FNP, the absolute value of this. Oops. That was just a C mistake, because in C it's called F, it's called F ups. And so here we see the frequency distribution of this. So remember, this is here the mirror of that side. So therefore, we see that they're looking identical on the left here, and on the right. And as obviously, if we see, they're not all frequencies in there at the same amplitudes. But if we do this for a very long time, then and we were averaging over this, then all frequencies were nicely distributed here. And so the question is now. So if you filter this now with our averaging filter, with our averaging FIR filter, then what we're expecting is that this here becomes smaller, and then this stays here. So let's just quickly draw this here. So we have our frequency spectrum, our input frequency spectrum, the noise. So that's our not NKK, X of K, and so that's the amplitude of this, and that looks like this, hopefully roughly the same. So, and this goes here up to Nyquist. So I'm not drawing the mirror here, so the mirror would be somewhere here. And so imagine now we filter this, so we use our averaging FIR filter. So what would we now expect? So remember the frequency, our frequency response of our filter. So if this is here H to E to J omega, so that was something like this. So that basically at Nyquist. At Nyquist, we have zero output. So, and therefore, here in our discrete Fourier transform scenario, again, so here, so that's K and that's Nyquist. That's Nyquist here. Then, what we would expect here at the output of our filter, so Y of K, that this would go slowly down like this. So that's our expectation. Yeah, so we convolve the input signal X of K with our filter response here, with our FIR filter, and then we should get this here as an output with that. So it's a bit like if you want to draw this, the processing stages. So that's basically happening here with our filter. So let's see if you're getting this result here. So let's just now do a filter operation. So we now only need to create an averaging filter. And so with that, we need to create an array, NP array. And then we know our coefficients, that's 0.5 and 0.5. So these ones, and now we just need to have a filter operation in Python, and this filter operation is called L filter, and it's in the signal processing module. So we need to first get our signal processing module, okay, so that's loaded, and then there's and now we can create our signal here. That's what I called X. Okay, so now we can call this here Y, and signal. The command is called L filter, and our coefficient goes in here in the first argument. Second one is one, and then the X is our input signal here. So let's plot this here first in the time domain, and I expect it looks pretty much the same as the original signal here. So if we look at that and at this here, so we don't see much difference. What you might notice is here, if you compare this plot with that plot in the time domain, this looks slightly smoother here because we have an averaging filter. But because we have 1000 samples, there's not much visibility of that because we're only averaging over two samples. And so therefore, now obviously the great advantage is the Fourier transform here. So we can just do a FFT of this, and we also need to take the absolute value of this. Okay. And now we see here very, very clearly when we compare this to our analytical solution here that this filtering has really succeeded, and that our filter with just two taps is able to be a very, very simple low-pass filter.